Good morning. Good to be with you this morning, even through the internet. Glad you could join us. If you haven't already, could you take a little time and greet the people watching with you on Facebook? Just type in good morning or maybe reply to some of their greetings. That's a great way for everybody to connect with each other a little bit in our worship time this morning. We'll begin then in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Dear friends, let us approach God with a true heart and confess our sins, asking Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us. Lord of life, I confess that I am by nature dead in sin, for faithless worrying and selfish pride, for sins of habit and sins of choice, for the evil I have done and the good I have failed to do. You should cast me away from your presence forever. O Lord, I am sorry for my sins. Forgive me for Jesus' sake. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. In His great mercy, God made us alive in Christ even when we were dead in our sins. Hear the word of Christ through His called servant. I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the well-being of all people everywhere, that they may receive from you all they need to sustain body and life, hear our prayer, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the spread of your life-giving gospel throughout the world, that all who are lost in sin may be brought to faith in you, hear our prayer, O Christ.
Christ, have mercy.
For patience and perseverance in this life, that we may not lose the hope of heaven as we await your return, hear our prayer, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord of life, live in us, that we may live for you.
Amen.
We join in the hymn. It's in the red hymnal, number 539. In Christ there is no east or west. Christ there is no east or west, in Him no south or north, but one great fellowship of love throughout the whole wide world. With God there is no tribe or race, in Him we all are. Set us free from sin, division, hate, and blame, from spite and envy. disciples of the faith, whate'er your race may be, who serves my Father as his child, is surely kin to me. In Christ thou meet both east and west, in him meet south and north. All Christly souls are one in him throughout the whole wide earth. This morning's gospel reading for Mother's Day is from Matthew chapter 12, beginning with verse 46. While Jesus was still talking to the crowd, his mother and brothers stood outside wanting to speak to him. Someone told him, "Your mother and brothers are standing outside wanting to speak to you." He replied to him, "Who is my mother? And who are my brothers?" Pointing to his disciples, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers, for whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother." My dear Garden Homes family, I was driving home the other day from the funeral home where I had had a prayer with the family of Mrs. Vera Bailey around her casket. And I was driving home, and as I was driving, I saw a touching scene on the porch of one of the houses I was driving past. On one end of that porch, there was what looked like a mother and her three daughters, and they were all bunched up on one end of the porch. They were all kind of almost sitting on top of each other because they were all trying to talk through one window of the house. And I could, of course, couldn't see who they were talking to inside the house. But they were obviously having a good time. They were smiling and chatting, and that's all I saw as I was driving past. But it's easy for me to imagine what's happening inside that house, right? It's easy for me to imagine that must be Grandma's house, and they want to go visit Grandma, but they don't dare go inside because they don't want to accidentally bring the coronavirus germs into Grandma's house. And so yet they want to see her. They miss her. They love her. So they're talking to her through the porch window of her house. And I've been in the same kind of scene, probably you have too, huh? where you want to visit, right? I want to visit my parents, I want to visit my wife's parents, and yet they're in the risk groups for the virus, and so we don't dare go inside their house. We got to visit with them outside. We're left standing outside the house, and still nice to see them, and still nice for them to see their grandkids, but we're left standing outside. And this kind of the scene that we have with Jesus in our Bible verses. Here we have Jesus' mother and his brothers, and they want to talk with Jesus. They've come to have a conversation with him, and yet Jesus leaves them standing outside, right? The place where Jesus is speaking is so full of people. Jesus is so popular. He attracts such a big crowd that they can't get to Jesus. And so they send word, "Hey, your mother, your brothers are outside." And it's like Jesus doesn't have any time for them. It's like he doesn't even have a minute for them. He doesn't even have one word of conversation with them. He talks almost as if it is an annoyance that they have come, an interruption in his day. And they are left standing outside. They don't get to talk to Jesus at all. And I tried to reimagine that scene that I saw when I was driving past the house. I tried to reimagine What if the grandma, who I think was in that house, right? What if she treated her family the way Jesus seems like he treated his in our verses? How would that have gone? All right, so imagine that with me. So the mother and the three daughters, they come up onto grandma's porch, they rap on the window, and grandma opens up the window, but she's on the phone with somebody else. And she says, "Hold on a minute." And she says, "What do you want? Who are you?" Completely surprised, right? The mother and the daughter, Grandma, we're here to visit you, right? This is your daughter, your granddaughters. We miss you. We love you. We want to talk with you. What do you say? My daughter and granddaughters? What are you talking about? I'm on the phone with the pizza place. I'm trying to order myself a deep dish pepperoni pizza. Oh, I have such a craving for this pizza. Now, my daughter and granddaughters, you say. And then grandma points to the phone and she says, "Here are my daughter and my granddaughters. This girl on the phone, she's going to bring me my pizza. She will be my daughter. And the other girls at the pizza place who are making this pizza for me that I want so much, they're going to be my granddaughters." And she closes the window. Wow, huh? Now what? Left standing outside, now rejected, replaced by grandma, right? Disowned by grandma, even. What's left for them to do? They just walk home. Go back to the car and go home. Sad. Is that how Jesus treats his family? Right? He almost seems like he's rejecting them or replacing them. He talks as if he doesn't even know them. Well, that's what he said. "Who is my mother? And who are my brothers?" I mean, really, the way Jesus talks is like he's disowning his own mother, his family, and finding somebody else. He says, here, these are the people. They can really give me what I want. These people, what they can give me, I want that so much. They're going to be my new family. Here is my new mother and my new brothers. That's the way Jesus talks. Of course, what Jesus wants so very much is a lot more noble and a lot more important than that deep dish pizza we imagined the grandma wanting. Right? Because what Jesus wants is for people to do the will of his Father in heaven. That's what he says, huh? "For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother." And of course, to do the will of Jesus' Father is to live a very beautiful and a useful life. What does it mean to do the will of Jesus' Father? It means, first of all, you know the value of every human being. You know the value of yourself because you know that God's Son went to the cross for you, for everybody. All right, to do the will of the Father in heaven means to show the kind of patience with other people that can only come from a heart that knows it is forgiven by God. To do the will of the Father in heaven is to love your neighbor, whoever they are, like you know you have been loved by Jesus. To do the will of your Father in heaven is to work for justice. It's to help the helpless. It's to show compassion at every turn. It is to be faithful in all things. It is to have always on your lips an encouraging word from Jesus whenever you run into a struggling soul. To do the will of the Father in heaven means all of that stuff you do with courage, unflagging courage, because you have your trust in God, in God's help, and in God's Son. And we like that about Jesus, that is so important to Jesus, to get people living that way, doing the will of his Father, because we know our world needs that very much. And yet it's still hard to see Jesus acting like this in these verses, right? It's hard to see Jesus acting like he doesn't know or care about his own family, especially nowadays, right? When we are separated. We're separated from each other. We're separated from our own families. We're separated from our parents. We're worried for them. Mother's Day, and we're afraid for our mothers, and we worry about their health because of what's all going on. And we want to know that Jesus cares about our families. And instead, we get these verses. It seems like Jesus doesn't care. He says, what? You going to talk to me? Too bad. I'm busy. You can stand outside. Who are you even? I can come up with a new family whenever I want. It's hard to see Jesus this way. And we think about even some of our own Garden Homes family who get their loved ones in the hospital and they can't even go to be with them. Right? Or their loved one is dying in the hospital and they can't even go and sit with their loved one for one last time because these rules, right, these restrictions that the hospitals have in our virus times. And it's awful, really. It's awful that our society should make rules like that, that people have to die alone. And we want to know Jesus cares about that. Doesn't Jesus think that's awful? Doesn't Jesus get sad about that? Doesn't he care about that? And then we read verses like this. Wow, it's not so obvious that Jesus would care about that, is it? Right? Because Jesus is like, who is my mother? And who are my brothers? Mother's brothers. What do they matter? Really, Jesus? You know, if all we had in the Bible were verses like this about Jesus, verses where he's talking like he's ignoring his own family, pushing them away, disavowing any kind of affection for them. If that's the only kind of verses we had about Jesus in the Bible, why would people want to follow him? Right? Or if somebody was really afraid for their family or grieving over a family member, why would they turn to him? Why would they think Jesus would care? He doesn't care about his own family. Why would he care about mine? And yet, we know Jesus better than that, huh? This is not all we have about Jesus in the Bible. We, by the grace of the Holy Spirit, we know a lot more about Jesus than that. We know that Jesus is love incarnate, right? He is the definition of caring and concern and love. And we know that Jesus was perfect in every way, right? He was tempted just like we are, but he never sinned. So that means he kept God the Father's will, like the part about honor your father and mother, right? The part about loving your own mother always, no matter what. Jesus did that. And you think about who Jesus' mother was. The woman who is highly favored by God, the woman who is called blessed among women. Probably Jesus had a lot of respect for her, huh? A lot of love for her. And even here, didn't he still love her? Or his little brothers and sisters. We think about Cain in Genesis chapter 4. Am I my brother's keeper? Jesus never talked like that, did he? No way. Right, throughout their growing up years, Jesus would have been praying for his little brothers and sisters and watching over them all the time perfectly, the perfect older brother. Although it didn't look like it right now, did it? But we can't always go by how things look. See, right now, Jesus was still on his path to dying on the cross for all people, including his mother, and his brothers, his sisters. And in fact, because we know the heart of Jesus, we know right then, right at that moment when he was leaving them outside, He cares so much about them. I mean, just look, Jesus is hanging on the cross. He can hardly breathe, right? And he thinks about his mother. And he talks to his mother. Remember that story? Or after Jesus rises from the dead, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 7, it says, he made a special point to appear to his brother James to make sure he believed that he was risen from the dead. Or after Jesus ascends into heaven, it seems as though two of Jesus' brothers, James and Jude, they became great teachers in the church, even books of the Bible written by them, named after them. So Jesus, he isn't disowning his family. He isn't rejecting them. He hasn't stopped loving them or caring about them, even though he leaves them standing outside and won't talk to them. And because we know the heart of Jesus like this, because we know all these things about Jesus, we can listen to Jesus' words and hear them in a different way. This is how we can hear Jesus' words. We can hear Jesus saying this. Well, how can I explain to you people how much it means to me when somebody does the will of my Father? How can I explain to you just the feelings that awaken in my heart when somebody turns from their own selfish ways and starts to do the will of my Father? You know, the only kind of love I could even compare to that is the love that I've had between my mother and me. The only kind of love I could compare with that is the love I felt between my little brothers and sisters and me. And so, yeah, you do the will of my Father in heaven. That's how I feel toward you. You are my mother and my brother and my sisters. Jesus isn't rejecting his family. He is saying, this is the most beautiful picture I can think of for how I feel when you do my Father's will. I can only compare it to what I felt in my own family. And so right then, right as Jesus seems like he has no time for his family, he talks like he doesn't even know them anymore, he talks like he's disowning them, right then Jesus is holding them so dear in his heart, they're so dear to him, that they are the most perfect picture he can think of for this blessedness of being in the communion of saints, this joy that he feels when somebody wants to belong to him and belong to his God. It's like how I've felt in my family, he says. Wow, you know, we need to be reminded how much we mean to Jesus. It's really easy to forget about that. Even in normal times, right? It's easy to forget how much we mean to Jesus. In normal times, right, we get so focused on our own messes. We get stressed, or we got an Excedrin headache, or people just keep getting frustrated with us, or it seems like all day all we're doing is putting out this fire and putting out the next fire and the next one. We get so focused on our own messes. It's so easy to forget. Hey, Jesus cares. Jesus is there, and put our trust in him. And then if we look around and we look at our society's messes, oh man, even in normal times, right? And sometimes it's kind of awful what normal times means in our country. We got some more headlines this week. A man killed, murdered for the crime of jogging while black. And you think, wow, you know, that's normal times for our country. Even in so-called normal times, we can be tempted to wonder, does Jesus really care? Why isn't Jesus fixing things? Why isn't he making things better? And then these aren't really normal times, are they? Oh, especially now, especially in times like these, we need to remember how much does Jesus care in these times, these fearful, hard times, these church-closing, family-separating times, these empty grocery store shelf times, these too many funeral times. In these times, you need to know Jesus is not disowning you. He's not forgetting you. And even though sometimes he talks like, who is my mother and who are my brothers? That doesn't mean his heart has changed. I, the Lord, do not change. Malachi chapter 3, verse 6. Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5. And it seems like Jesus doesn't care about you or about your family or about your messes or about society. Jesus cares. You are so dear to Him. You are family to Him. And it seems like Jesus doesn't have time for you, and all you want to do is talk to Him and be close to Him, and He just leaves you standing outside like he just is pushing you away, or maybe it seems like He's replacing you because He found some more godly people over here. He likes them instead. No, Jesus isn't like that. You are dear to Him. You're so dear to Him. Oh, but sometimes it can seem like He's leaving you, standing in the cold like His own mother was that day. And doesn't mean that tells you what's in His heart. In Jesus' heart, He never loses sight of His desire to save you and to save your family. And more than that, you are so dear to Him as somebody who is striving to do the will of His Father in heaven. You are so dear to Him. He says He can't even think of a more beautiful love than the love you have for Him. He says you are as dear and precious to Him as His own mother. You're so dear to Him as that. And then we aren't even talking about how much the Father loves you, right? The Father, He loves you so much, not just because you are doing His will, but also because you are so dear to His Son. Two perfect loves. Even when it seems Jesus doesn't care. Perfect love, the love of the Father, the love of the Son, a love that points to you and says, you are my brother, my sister, my mother. Oh, we need to be reminded of this, how much Jesus cares. Because, yeah, sometimes when you're doing the Father's will, it's real nice. Real nice. It's obvious. God is answering your prayer. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. And you get a little taste of heaven. Maybe people even start acting like the people in heaven. Sometimes doing the Father's will is like that. But sometimes doing the Father's will is like Gethsemane. You remember that? Remember the garden where Jesus, He says He was so overcome with sorrow, it was taking Him to the point of death. And none of His friends would keep watch with Him. And He's praying in such anguish that His sweat is like whole drops of blood. And yet, what does He pray? Not my will, Father, but yours be done. Sometimes doing the Father's will is like that. Sometimes doing the Father's will means sorrow. And it means hard prayers to pray. And it means the only people who have kisses left for you are your betrayers. Sometimes doing the Father's will is like that, and yet even then, especially then, Jesus, the Son of God in heaven, Jesus points to you in front of all of His angels, and He says, look right there, look at how that person, that dear, darling person is so beautifully carrying out my Father's will. That right there, that's my brother, that's my sister, that's my mother, says Jesus. And we think about some of our Garden Homes family that we have lost, right, that we have sent to heaven in the past weeks. And we think about how we haven't gotten to say goodbye to them the way we would have wanted. But think about now, finally, Jesus gets to say hello to them the way that He has wanted for so long. Oh, and don't think that when our dear Garden Homes friends got to the gates of heaven, they were left standing outside. No, Jesus could not treat them that way. These people who have done his Father's will, and now he has finally brought them to victory. No, rather, we should look at that part of our verses this morning, the part where Jesus is pointing at his family, and we should imagine and know that that is how our loved ones from Garden Homes, that's how they were greeted when they got to heaven. That's how it was. Can you think of that? Can you think of our dear Garden Homes loved ones? And the angels, their angels, are carrying them through the gates of paradise. And Jesus, the glorious Son of God, he lights up, right? He lights up and he starts pointing. He starts pointing in front of all the saints of heaven. He's pointing at them. No, not just pointing. He gets right up out of his exalted throne. He gets up because he can't just sit there, and he runs. He hurries over to our friends, our loved ones. He hurries over to them and he says, Jesus says, you're here. You're finally here. My brother, my sister, my mother. Amen. The peace of God, which goes beyond understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's continue with our next hymn. If you have your hymnal, it's number 451 in the red hymnal. Precious Lord, take my hand. Our prayers today, we include our dear friend and church member, Mr. Tony Little. I spoke to him a few days ago. He just said he, as you know from last Sunday, he had been re-diagnosed with the COVID-19, and it's just kind of wiping him out. It was hard for him to get up and do anything. It's just making him so weak. So we pray for his continued recovery and God's blessings on the family's efforts to move. They have to move out of their current place. This week they're supposed to be out. So God's blessing on them. We have several prayer requests from our sister, Mrs. Brenda Witkowski. So a little boy named Zion, that's a four-year-old nephew of Fred Collier. Fred, many of you probably know, often comes to church with Brenda's daughter, Kofi. And so Fred's nephew, Zion, has always been a very healthy boy, but recently became totally unresponsive. He's been hospitalized. He is more responsive and aware, but still it is a serious situation for little Zion. We pray also for Brenda's cousin, Ricky, 50-year-old. Ricky was just tested positive for COVID-19. And we pray for Brenda's 90-year-old aunt, Georgie, who is hospitalized. And then another request, we received a prayer request from our ninth grader, Aviana Story. She says, can you please pray for my mom, who is working in the medical field and with COVID patients. Pray that God would keep her safe. So these are our special prayers. Today we'll pray also for mothers on this Mother's Day. Please join me in prayer. Lord God, you form the minds of your faithful people into a single will. Make us love what you command and desire what you promise, that among the many changes of this world, our hearts may always yearn for you and yearn for the lasting joys of heaven. This morning we lift up and commend into your care Tony Little, Sr. Please continue to bless his recovery from COVID-19 and bless his family's efforts to move into their new home. Please keep them strong and leaning on you, and take all their frustrations and their stresses and put them into your hands. We pray for the family of Brenda Witkowski. We pray for little Zion, a nephew of Fred, and Brenda's cousin Ricky, and Brenda's aunt Georgie. Please command your angels concerning them to guard them. You are the God who forgives all our sins and heals all our diseases. Please grant that peace of forgiveness and that strength of your healing to Zion and Ricky and Georgie. We pray for Aviana's mother. Keep her safe even as she puts herself in harm's way to care for the sick, to care for the coronavirus patients. We pray for all of those in the same position who are fearful for their family members who had to go in and expose themselves to this virus day after day. Please grant your protection as you promise you will watch over our coming and our going both now and forevermore. And this is what we pray for our loved ones, for those in harm's way. Watch over them. This Mother's Day, we pray to you, dear God. You are the source of life, of wisdom, and of all good things. We pray that you would look with favor on all mothers. By your help, they gave life to their children. By your strength, they nurture their children with loving concern and faithful instruction. May their children always honor them and call them blessed. We pray for mothers today. When they become weary, dear God, sustain them. Give them physical and spiritual rest when they need it. Yes, we pray that you would hear us for the sake of your Son, Jesus, who we know loved his earthly mother perfectly and in whom you are well pleased. Finally, Heavenly Father, in these fearful times, grant that we would keep putting our trust in you in all things. Help us not to lean on our own understanding or our own clear vision of what the future holds, but to lean on you. You are the Alpha and the Omega. Before the mountains were here, you are God. And you're going to outlast this virus and any other thing we fear or worry about. Thank you. Thank you for being that big of a God. Grant us a big faith in you and in your love. And we pray as Jesus has taught us, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Amen. Our closing hymn is from the Blue Songbook, number 34, Born in Cry. I was there to hear your born in cry. I'll be there when you are home. I rejoice the day you were baptized to see your life unfold. I was there when you were but a child with a faith suit you well. In a place of light you wandered off to find where demons dwell. When you heard the wonder of the word, I was there to cheer you on. You were raised as one. I'll be there to make your verses run from dusk till rising sun. In the middle ages of your life, not too old, no longer young, I'll be there to guide to plead what I've begun. When the evening gently closes in and you shut your weary eyes, I'll be there as I have always been, with just one more surprise. I was there to hear your morning cry. I'll be there when you are old. I rejoice the day you were baptized to see your life unfold. Great to be with you this morning. We have an opportunity for you if you want to give your offering online. There should be a link there on the Facebook page. Otherwise, go to our church website, gardenhomeslutheran.org, and there's a donate page there that you can take care of your offering that way, or mail it in. We have quite a few members this past week mailing some of their offerings in. Thank you for that. Thank you. I encourage you to, if you haven't been, to be greeting each other and talking to each other on the Facebook page right there. You can, somebody says good morning, you can hit reply and you can say, how are you? Have a whole conversation. This is a time when we're separated, but we can interact with each other. And then you maybe don't know, maybe you do, but an easy way for you to invite somebody to this church service is hit that share button on the Facebook page under the picture of the service. Just hit share, and you're sharing that then on your Facebook page and letting your friends and so on be invited to watch what you've just watched. Next Sunday, we have our live stream plan for 9 a.m. and we're going to try to do something special that would have been our confirmation day. Right now we have, looks like, maybe 10 confirmands who will be ready. A couple are delaying until after all the virus calms down, but it looks like we're going to have 10 confirmands, and what we've been doing is confirming them individually. We're bringing them in, videotaping the confirmation and their first communion, and then our third grade teacher, Mrs. Mackey, is working to compile all those videos into one shorter video that we're going to show during our live stream next Sunday so that we can kind of have a confirmation day together that way. So I'm looking forward to that. It's not nearly as fun as the real thing, just as we could say that every Sunday. But still, we're going to try to make it a special day next Sunday for them. I think those who are the main things to cover, except to say that God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.